Welcome to People. I'm Shirley Lin. Today, my guest is Gabriele Seewald of Rejuvenate. She's the founder of Rejuvenate, and she's been in Taiwan for more than 4 years. She's here with her husband and 3 children. Well, originally she's from Austria, I believe. So let's have a chat with Gabriele. Hi, Gabriele.
Hello, Shirley. Hello,
thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you.
Yeah.
For having me.
Right. So you're originally from Austria.
That's right.
But since several years ago, you've been around Asia, right? Am I right?
I actually moved to Asia around 12 years ago.
Okay.
As a student. I went to Beijing first.
Because you wanted to study Chinese?
I wanted to learn Chinese, that's right.
And why?
Originally, I have been introduced to China by my parents,
okay,
who had their own business, and especially my father, he has been traveling to Asia, including China, for many, many years.
Oh, he's a businessman.
That's right.
I see.
Yeah, international trading.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I have to say, I feel very lucky because I think my parents did one really fantastic thing. They regularly took us on business trips.
Mm. Which, when you said us, you have brothers and sisters?
That's right, yeah. I have a younger sister and a younger brother as well.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
So the 3 of you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And of course, that was a great experience.
Yeah.
I really wish and hope I can do that with my own children as well, because I think it's something you cannot learn in any school.
Yeah.
Or in any classroom.
I know, and being exposed to different countries and different cultures and different people and food.
That's right.
Yeah, it
that's
really right. enriches people's lives.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's, I would say, how I kind of fell in love with Chinese culture,
okay,
and Chinese
what,
speaking
you mean the
Asia.
Food?
Also.
Okay.
Of course, as well.
Yeah. Okay. So how old were you when you started traveling abroad? I mean,
with my
your parents? Yeah.
I was 12, actually.
Really?
I was 12, yeah.
Well, oh, great. So that's good. Being exposed, you know, at that young age to the world.
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, but your dad was mostly traveling to Asia, here to Asia.
That's right. A lot. He started at a very, very early for Europe, I would say. He started to travel to Asia a lot. It was actually 35 years ago, mm-hmm, when he started.
His own business?
No. It was my grandparents' business already.
Yeah.
But he started to travel to Asia
around
35 years ago. And he took me and my sister the first time to Asia on a business trip, mm-hmm, when I was 16.
Mm-hmm.
And we went to Hong Kong, we went to China, and I declared to my dad back then that I want to learn Chinese.
Oh, do your parents speak Chinese?
No, they don't. Just very little.
Yeah.
Like ni hao and zai tian and xie xie, those kind of things.
Oh, okay.
But of course, they could relate to it, right?
Yeah.
They were very supportive that I wanted to learn Chinese.
Why?
Because they themselves were exposed to it.
Right.
They saw the opportunities arising.
Uh-huh. But I meant, like, why?
Why did I wanna
learn
Chinese?
To learn Chinese?
I don't know. It was really something, you know, when I went on that business trip with my dad, as I said, it was coming from my heart, I would say.
Mm.
I really fell in love with the culture here.
Oh, wow.
And I said, okay, I wanna just be able to communicate. I wanna be able to at least speak to the people here.
Okay.
And be able to, you know, listen to them, know a bit more about their lifestyle, their backgrounds, and that's basically what I did. But mm. I waited, because back then, honestly speaking, in Austria, it was actually not that easy to learn Chinese.
Yeah.
When I was 16, I remember the only place pretty much you could go to learn Chinese was the university in Vienna.
Okay.
So I said, okay, fine. I'll, you know, finish high school first, and after actually graduating from university in Austria, I decided to go to Beijing to learn Chinese there.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So you moved there by yourself?
I moved there by myself.
And how long were you in Beijing?
I was in Beijing for a little over a year.
Mm-hmm.
Then I moved back to Austria for just a short while, because I got the chance to actually work for a tour operator. who had just established a department for incoming tourists from China to Austria and Europe.
Oh, so you became a tour guide?
Not a tour guide, no. Uh-huh. I worked in marketing, okay. Marketing and sales. Okay. Like that's more my background also from university. It's mainly marketing, sales, business development.
So wait a minute. You only spent 1 year in Beijing.
That's right.
And you mastered your Chinese. Just that one year?
Well, mastered, I don't know. I can communicate.
But then when you went back to Austria and started working
yes.
In the field of using Chinese, you were able to communicate with
absolutely,
Chinese?
Absolutely, absolutely.
You was got fine. A talent for languages, probably.
Probably a bit of a talent, but I would say it's really my passion. Mm. I guess that really also, you know,
that helps.
Was driving me and that really helped.
Yeah.
At least, you know, spoken communication.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then you went back to Austria and you worked for how long before you, the next stop was Beijing. Not Beijing, Hong Kong.
The next stop was actually Hong Kong because right. I met my husband on a business trip.
Wait a minute. So you went to Hong Kong on a business trip.
That's right.
And that's how you met your husband?
Exactly.
Okay, well, tell us more. What was he doing?
My husband has also, I would say, quite a long relationship with China already.
Okay.
He went there when he was 17. My husband was born and brought up in Canada.
Oh.
But his parents are originally from Austria as well.
Ah, and I was just going to say, Seewald, that last name.
Yes, that's right.
It's Austrian.
It's Austrian. Okay. Very Austrian name,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But he was born and brought up in Vancouver, and his dad was in the construction business. So they had some relationship with, you know, Vancouver, a lot of Chinese.
Yes.
Asians there.
Yeah.
And he as well actually wanted to learn Chinese, but he started with Cantonese.
Ah.
And so he went, when he was 17 already, he went actually to work in a toy factory close to Guangzhou, close to Dongguan,
uh-huh.
Just as a summer job, basically.
Okay.
And he started to learn Cantonese there. So he has also a quite long relationship with China, Chinese speaking, Asia, the culture. Yeah. He spent some time also before in Taiwan.
Mm-hmm.
And then he actually, after graduating from law school in Canada, he moved to Hong Kong to practice as a lawyer there.
Ah.
That is what he was doing when we met.
Okay.
That's...
You know, I was just thinking, I should have asked you and your husband to come in and do the interview together.
That's right. Maybe next time.
Next time. Wow. Okay. But how did your business trip cross with his work in Hong Kong?
Well, actually, the I would say the connection was our Austrian heritage.
Oh.
Me being from Austria and his parents originally from Austria, he was always involved with the Austrian community in Hong Kong.
I see.
And he actually, together with a very good Austrian-Canadian friend as well, they established the Austrian Chamber of Commerce in Hong Kong.
Ah.
And I happened to be there, like my business trip happened to coincide with the inaugural dinner of the Austrian Chamber of Commerce in Hong Kong.
Okay.
And that's where we met.
Was it love at first sight? It sounded like love at first sight.
In a way, yes. In a way, yes. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
But the thing is, you were on a business trip, so then you actually went back to Austria?
That's right. It was just a business trip. I went back.
Yep. But you kept in touch.
Well, obviously, he was very convincing.
Yeah.
He really convinced me to move to Hong Kong.
Just like that?
Well, I always say just like that. Yes and no. You know, I would say I am a person, I very much follow my heart.
Okay.
I trust my heart and myself
mm-hmm.
and my feelings in a way. And yes, in some ways, you know, sometimes looking back or some of my friends would tell me, oh, you know, this is maybe a bit crazy or it takes a lot of courage.
Yeah.
But in the end, I realized whenever I followed my heart, whatever, whether it was with my relationship, moving to Hong Kong, you know, things just kept falling into its place. It was like something even better, mm-hmm. you know, showed up in the end.
Mm-hmm.
And something most of the time totally unexpected. And that's also what actually happened when I decided to move to Hong Kong. I said, okay, you know, I met this fantastic man,
yeah.
And at least, you know, I have a relationship. I like Asia. I like Chinese speaking Asia. So that step for me, I would say, wasn't that difficult.
Mm-hmm.
But it was important for me as well, you know, to still, you know, be independent, because we didn't really know each other for a long time. I said, okay, you know, why not? Let's have a look. Let's give it a try. But I definitely, you know, want to find a job there. I want to be able to be independent as well.
Mm.
And after I had made this decision, well, opportunities just showed up, basically. And I got the chance to work for an Austrian jewelry brand.
Okay.
They were just at that time looking actually for a business development manager for all of Asia.
Oh.
At that time, they didn't have anything in Asia except for Japan.
Uh-huh.
And they were looking into finding someone who can help them to, you know, set up their company, set up the office in Hong Kong, set up the store as well, and out of Hong Kong, you know, develop the region. And, you
wow.
know, I got invited. I got lucky. I'm really very grateful. But I do also very much believe in taking opportunities.
Mm.
So I showed up for the interview. I said, you know what? I honestly speaking have no experience in that specific kind of industry, like work experience.
Okay.
I mean, it helped a little bit. I think that my parents' business actually was in jewelry for many years.
Oh, wow.
But specifically, you know, high-end luxury jewelry retail, I had no specific experience. But I said, I would like to do it, you know,
mm-hmm.
And everything just happened, you know.
And you got the job?
I got the job. I moved to Hong Kong in, when was it, July 2004.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it was afterwards that you got married, that you moved to Hong Kong and then got married. So
I moved to Hong Kong.
From the time you first met your husband to
yes.
getting married was a
about
span
2 years.
Of,
oh,
okay,
2 years.
2 years.
Yeah, yeah, about 2 years.
Okay. And I believe you had your first child, well, actually it was a pair of twins in
That's
Hong
right.
Kong.
That's right.
How much longer after you guys got married?
About 2 years as
two
well.
Years.
One
okay.
and a half, 2 years, 2007.
Yeah.
We got married in Guangzhou, actually.
Oh, interesting. So do you speak any Cantonese?
Xiu xiu a, just a little bit.
我都唔記得曬了.
Oh, wow. 不錯啊.
Oh, wow. So this is so interesting. Like, everything just kind of worked into place, huh?
That's right.
You've been very lucky.
That's
so,
right.
So to speak.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So how do you think Hong Kong compares to Taiwan?
Well, for me, and I would say probably also for my husband, we love Hong Kong, we love Taiwan as well, for different reasons.
Oh.
And I would say also different phases in our life.
Uh-huh.
Right now, with the children, like our twins are 6 and a half now,
mm-hmm.
and our daughter is 3 and a half.
Right, afterwards you had another daughter.
That's
mm-hmm.
right. She was, by the way, born here in
here,
Taiwan.
Here, right.
And so right now, for this phase in our life, with the children being quite young, we think Taiwan really offers probably the best quality of life in Asia.
Mm. Really?
People are very friendly.
Yeah.
And I would say a little bit more relaxed
mm-hmm.
than Hong Kong.
Uh-huh.
You have, in a way, more space.
Yeah.
It's
oh,
more,
for sure.
The nature is fantastic
yeah.
here. I mean, we love, as a family, we love hiking, for example. You know, Yangmingshan.
Yeah.
It is still, I would say, relatively affordable, you know, to live in a nice house with garden, because we always wanted our children to grow up in a more natural environment. In a way, like my husband and I, we grew up, you know, just being able to run outside the house, right?
Yeah.
Or ride the bike on the street where we grew up.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what we can, this opportunity we can give our children here in Taiwan.
So what brought you from Hong Kong to Taiwan then?
Originally, my husband's job.
Yeah.
By the way, my husband's name is Leo.
Right.
And he was offered the opportunity for his previous company, actually, to move to Taiwan for a few years.
Wow, that just moved into place as well.
Exactly.
Okay.
And, well, we said, why not? Let's take a look. Honestly speaking, we both had been to Taiwan before, but just more on business trips, short term. Right. And at that time, I have to say, we also really, I really didn't know that much about Taiwan. Mm. But we said, let's come over. And originally, we were actually just planning to stay 2-3 years and then move back to Hong Kong.
Oh, really?
However, after we moved here, first our daughter was born,
right,
which we're very happy about. Mm-hmm. And then...
So the twins are boys?
The twins are boys, okay. Yeah. They're both boys, mm-hmm. Yeah. And then we realized we really enjoy the lifestyle here. Mm-hmm. We enjoy the quality of life, the nature. And then the opportunity for me came along to start my own business here.
Right.
So we realized, we said, okay, you know, we actually like to stay longer. We like to stay for a while. And so we, last year, 2013, we actually made the decision that we want to stay in Taiwan. Mm. I would say for at least, if possible, another 3-4 years.
Okay.
Because our boys, our twins, Leo and Philip, they started elementary school.
Okay.
2013. Uh-huh. We think as well the education is very good here because we want our children to learn Chinese.
Yes, by the way, Leo and Gabrielle put their children in local schools here in Taiwan.
That's right, yes.
This is amazing. How did you decide to do that? I guess it has to do with what common decision or, you know, what you want for your children that you decide to put them in local schools.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, I would say the key decision factor for us was the Chinese.
Okay.
Because we said they will be growing up in Chinese-speaking Asia. Like for us, this is home, whether it's Taiwan or probably later on Hong Kong, South China, or between the places. This is home for us. So they will be growing up here. And also for both my husband and I, since we learned Chinese more the hard way when we were adults already, right?
Oh, okay.
I would say it's much more difficult.
Okay.
We said, okay, we want to give them this opportunity. I think Chinese is such an important language nowadays.
Yeah.
You really have a huge advantage, mm-hmm. especially if you can also read and write Chinese. And you learn it from a very early age,
right.
You learn it in a very natural way. You don't think about it yet. For them, that's natural, right? Because they had it in kindergarten already, and now they continue with elementary school. So I would say this was the key decision factor for us.
There is the Austrian language, right?
German.
Okay.
German, yeah. That's okay.
I'm so ignorant.
But there is, yeah. Okay. Austrian uses little bit different dialect or words. But basically it's
German. So do your children speak German?
That's right, yeah. They do speak German, yeah.
So, but they don't learn that at school, though?
No.
So you have tutoring for them in German or?
No.
Or
basically what we did is, uh-huh. since German is my mother tongue.
Okay.
And my husband as well grew up with German at home.
Okay.
It was, I think, also very lucky that his mother, like my mother-in-law, really, it was very important to her as well that the children learn German because it's her mother tongue as well. Mm-hmm. So we decided that in our home from the beginning, we will speak German.
I see.
And I only speak German with them.
Ah.
Of course, my husband, since he's like a native English as well, English speaker, now that they're a little bit older, they speak sometimes English with him.
Okay.
But for me, it's really only German. And since it's the mother tongue, you know, it's basically the first language they learned.
Yeah.
I'm very happy, but I also got the impression at least that they felt very comfortable, very secure. Because the mother tongue, I think it's really so important. Uh-huh. Once they have that basis, that they feel secure in the mother tongue, just speaking, then any other language is easy for them to learn.
Oh, wow. So actually your children are now trilingual, Chinese,
yes.
English, and German.
In a way, yes.
Yeah. So you speak to them in German, your husband speaks to them in English, and then they learn the Chinese at school.
That's right.
And then with the classmates.
Yes.
Wow. You know, I could never do that with my children. I know that my other colleague, she would talk to her children in English.
Yeah.
And whereas her husband would talk to them in Chinese, so they grew up being bilingual.
Yeah.
And I thought, I want to do the same thing too, but I just couldn't do it. You know, it just takes, I just didn't have the perseverance, I guess. I only managed to persevere for maybe like a week or two.
Okay.
Because every time I talk to them, my kids when they were younger in English, they're going like, 妈妈在说什么? What is mom saying? And then they'll turn to my husband and said, what's mom saying? And I was like, oh, this is too tiring, you know. I feel like I have to say in Chinese and then, no, what was it? Say it in English and then translate into Chinese for them.
Yeah.
Then what's the point? So eventually
That's right.
I gave up.
Yeah.
So I don't know, how could you and Leo do it? I find it so hard.
Well, it is not always easy, I agree with you.
Yeah.
May I ask, your mother tongue is Chinese as well?
Right, what is my mother tongue? Because I left Taiwan when I was 5 years old.
Yeah,
and
okay.
We moved to Hong Kong, and
All
that's
right.
where I learned Cantonese. And then when we moved to Japan, we went to international school.
Yeah.
So it was in English, except for the Japanese classes, we learned Japanese.
Okay.
And then to the States then I've been using English ever since I went to college.
Mm.
So I would say, I don't know.
Yeah.
It's either English or Chinese.
English or Chinese.
So that's where the problem is, because I couldn't even figure out what my mother tongue is.
Well, I would say it probably is a bit more tricky then.
Really?
In our case, at least it was very easy for me, because for me, very clear, you know, I was born, I grew up in Austria, so my mother tongue is German.
Right.
And I think one thing that really helped, especially at the beginning, was that my husband Leo also speaks German very well, because
right.
they spoke German at home.
Mm-hmm.
So at least, you know, we had this kind of one family language
right.
that everyone can speak and understand.
Yep.
Because I think if the two parents, right, like if the other one doesn't speak any German,
mm-hmm.
it also is more difficult, because then you will always, mm-hmm. when you speak to your children, you will always have to, in a way, also translate to your husband, right? So I think that actually helped a lot, with the German.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, anyway, but that is great. So everything would just kind of work really well. You know, I got the feeling that things have always been going so well for you ever since you were a child. Was there any hardship at all?
Yes.
Any times of failure?
Yes.
Which is not considered bad?
No.
Yes?
Yes.
What was it, and when was it, and what happened? And
yeah. Well, thank you for asking, because I know, I think that's actually a very important point, because uh-huh. I know that people often tell me, you know, well, for you, everything just seems to go so, you know,
smoothly.
And well, the truth is, I think as every person in every life, I've had hardships as well,
mm-hmm.
and failures or health issues,
okay.
All kinds of things.
Uh-huh.
And most of the time, to tell you the truth, when I had really great things happening in my life,
mm-hmm.
like the first time when I met my husband,
mm-hmm.
or when our children were born,
mm-hmm.
at the same time, I would actually also encounter the other side of things,
uh-huh.
meaning there would also be a big challenge in that.
Okay.
The first time when I met my husband, honestly speaking, the big challenge was that I was in a relationship in Austria for many years.
Oh, okay.
I was not married, but I was in a relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I had built up my life there.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a big challenge in there as well.
Mm-hmm.
How to, you know, be able to solve that in a good way.
Mm-hmm.
Or when I had the children, I encountered a lot of health issues after giving birth,
mm-hmm.
Whether it was with my skin rashes, very low energy level,
mm-hmm.
My liver was totally, you know, toxified towards the end of the twin pregnancy.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, also with the business here in Taiwan, you know, starting a new business
mm-hmm.
from scratch, from
a lot
zero,
of pressure.
Just 2 years ago, naturally, I do encounter a lot of challenges.
Mm-hmm.
But I realized in a way that whatever it was that I encountered, even in the situation, it sometimes was very difficult and
mm-hmm.
very hard. And there was sometimes, it required from me often to really, you know, make changes. Start with myself, make changes, come back to, you know, who I really am. Be myself and take the necessary steps. And sometimes in certain phases of my life, yes, it has actually at that time affected me a lot. You know, I didn't feel well, I didn't sleep well, as, you know, almost I would say everyone sometimes has that experience in certain phases. But at the same time, I also know that I always learned from it. And there was always something, this is me, you know, I always try to find what's the good thing in everything.
Okay.
What is it that I can learn that helps me to move on, to move forward? And, you know, not, I have probably one of the biggest lessons I have learned is to be able, you know, to go through challenges, but it is still actually my decision how I react to it.
Okay.
How, you know, I can still feel well. I can still be happy. I don't have to react in a negative way. And I think that helps a lot.
You are a very positive person.
Yes,
that's
I am.
I see you.
Yes, I am.
Yeah,
that's true.
That
I
helps.
Am. Yeah, that helps a lot.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, then that brings us to this business
yes.
of yours, Rejuvenate.
That's right.
So I feel like it has a lot to do with how you, I mean, things that you went through yourself.
That's right.
That's why you started
That's right.
this business.
Exactly.
Interesting.
Absolutely.
So you want to talk about what this is? I mean, you were trying to explain to me that they were actually, in the beginning, there were some products, you know.
That's right.
That uses natural resources and all that kind of stuff. And how it originated from Germany, but then now you kind of choose products from Australia. And but then now you also add it in with seminars. And giving, I don't know, speeches and conferences or, you know, forums about how to rejuvenate yourself,
That's right.
Yeah. So this is, it actually had, now I realize it has a lot to do with yourself, of what you went through. And that's why you started this
that's
thing.
That's right.
And
that's
you want to share with a lot of people.
Absolutely.
In their workplace, in their health, in themselves, either also on the complexion.
Everything. Inside out, I would say.
Inside out.
Yeah.
So you want to talk a little bit about that? I mean, how it got started? And
I love to. Yeah, well, basically it started that the opportunity again came to me. As I have to say, I'm also very much a believer in opportunities. I do really believe opportunities come to everyone. But we have to recognize them and we have to take them if we want to.
Okay.
And in that sense, I'm a person, I like to take the opportunities to come to me. So it started about 2 years ago when a German company approached me to basically bring their product, their brand to Taiwan.
Oh, so this company approached you.
That's right.
Another lucky moment here.
An opportunity.
Okay.
That presented itself.
Huh.
So I looked into it and I realized, oh, this is so interesting. And in many ways, it relates a lot to who I am and my experiences. Because the product was natural and focused on cell care.
Cell care.
So
what exactly
for the
is that?
Skin.
It's deeper than the skin. Is
That's
that?
Right.
Okay.
It's really the cellular level. In a way, it's, you know, the smallest part in a way, the cells that we are made up. Our whole physical body is made up of billions and billions of cells. And working with this brand, with this product, which focus mainly on the beauty, on the skin, I realized that, wow, this is really interesting. And I also learned a lot. I learned that there's a lot of new scientific findings as well in that area of cell care and our cellular system. And one of the latest actually scientific findings is that everything, meaning our mindset, so what we think, what we say, how we behave, what we eat, of course, like everything we take into our body, what we eat, what we drink, what we exercise, and how we do things as well, as well as all the products we use every day, all the ingredients, we feed a lot of things every day to our body.
Yep. And we are what we eat, isn't it?
In a way, yes. Yeah. But eating is like actually physically eating food is right. only one part of it, okay. but an important part. Mm-hmm. But we feed so many things, in a way, information to our body down to our cellular level. Mm. It's to a certain extent always absorbed and stored in the way of information in our cells. Mm-hmm. So, but they also realized, the scientists, that we really can do a lot. We can help ourselves or our cells to regenerate,
okay.
to become more healthy, uh-huh. You know, to have better well-being, to have better energy, to yeah, have better vitality, to look better, to feel better, to look younger at any age. Uh-huh. And this is the core of basically what we do.
Wow.
For people. But then, you know, realized working, starting with the brand and in a way, you know, evolving into other areas, as you mentioned, like we work a lot with experts now in that area as well, Taiwanese and international experts, where we give seminars, workshops, coachings as well, to help people, but also organizations, because in essence, what's an organization or a company? It's made up of a group of people.
Yeah.
We help them to find the approach, the way, or even the product or service that works for them, that helps them to rejuvenate.
Oh, wow.
In everything, that's something very important to me. Like any person we work with or any company, any product, we always look at, you know, that things are done with well-being, mm-hmm. with integrity, mm-hmm. with authenticity. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to the products, like mm-hmm. you mentioned, the new skincare from Australia that we are bringing in this year into Taiwan, it's really 100% natural. And certified organic, which is, I think, nowadays very, very important, because I realized people are becoming more aware of what is in the products they consume every day. Yeah. We had a few scares there as well, unfortunately, almost everywhere in the world. Mm-hmm. But again, I tend to look at it in a positive way, because I think it's good. We just know more now. Uh-huh. We know more about those ingredients. We are more educated. Consumers are more educated nowadays. Mm-hmm. So we can also make more educated and conscious decisions about which products we use.
I feel like what you're doing is adding positiveness on top of already a very positive person. It's just, you know, double
well, thank
the dose.
You.
Double the dose.
Thank you.
Wow, it's really been a pleasure speaking with you and learning and hearing your story.
Likewise. Yeah. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Yeah, it's really great
for giving
you,
me
Gabriele.
This opportunity. Okay. Likewise, Shirley. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for watching, people. I'm Shirley Lin.